Hello, I am Chauncey DeVega. You may recognize my voice from Ring of Fire Radio with Mike Papantonio, the BBC, Sirius XM, or the Tom Hartman Radio Show. And you may have read some of my essays at places like Salon and Alternate. I would like to thank all of you for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show.
And they ran a story by somebody named Chauncey DeVega.
Quote, I find black garbage pail kids, black conservatives, fascinating.
That's just unbelievable. You know,
he goes by the name of Chauncey DeVega.
You know, I've been called Uncle Tom, Oreo, sellout, shameless. But this is a new one.
Well, let's talk now to Chauncey DeVega.
As my man Chauncey DeVega of the blog We Are Respectable Negroes says,
I have author and blogger Chauncey DeVega here with us.
Hello, and welcome to an especially fun, sexy, and smart episode of the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. Feeling more up energy than last week, boy. That last podcast week, man, I was tired. Y'all could hear it in my voice. Feeling a little better this week. It's so nice. I love the fall. It is cool here in Chicago. I'm one of these strange black folk, from what I have been told, who loves the winter. Apparently, black folks don't love the winter. I love the fall. I love the crispness in the air. Crispness. You see that? Got so excited I couldn't enunciate my crispnesses there properly. But I got my Coca-Cola. Hold on. Let me get the swig. Ooh, that's so good. You know that's the ritual. And the Chauncey DeVega Show is fun and sexy and smart just by virtue of my mere presence. We understand that. We understand that Chauncey DeVega is a sex god. A man of letters and genius. A Renaissance man who takes off his clothes and oils himself up and poses like Arnold Schwarzenegger in Pumping Iron. Want me to hear the, a theme song? Dun, dun, dun. Now visualize it. Dun, dun, dun. Dun, dun, dun. I'm flexing them pecs now. Dun, dun, dun. Shooing the full muscular. Dun, dun, dun. Dun, dun, dun. You know I look horrible when I'm oiled up. That's my self-deprecating humor. You know, you got to laugh at yourself sometimes. I love that movie. If you have not seen Pumping Iron, go out and get that Pumping Iron. And I'm recovering. I told folks last time, my exercising, because my bum leg cost me exercise time for the summer trying to get back into it. I did some Hindu squats. Only did about 50 of them. I could barely walk for a week. I look like Fred Sanford. So I'm back in effect. Now I know I got to stretch. I'm not the young man I used to be. But as I said, especially sexy, especially fun episode. The one and only great adult actress, sex educator, media personality, and I dare say a historian of American and global culture, especially around matters of sex and gender. The one and only Nina Hartley. So she and I sit down like I joked last time. I'm just in the car. I'm in the Cadillac car. And she's Cotton Hill, pulled up in that Cadillac car. And I was going to drive it, and she told me to scoot on over, Chauncey, because I'm driving this Cadillac car. So it's a fun episode. And as I said, I always thank you guys, because sometimes out of the blue, and I have some other folks that I'm angling to speak to all this week. So it's either going to be a flush week or it's going to come up zeros. I had some great conversations, though, two great ones, in one day on Monday for future episodes. One with a writer for Vice Sports. He's also contributed to the Washington Post and elsewhere. Jezebel. Another great guest who is an educator, writer, working class, white brother, who is a professor, student, scholar of neoliberalism and race. He and I chatted up, so that was a twofer on one day. But I got some other folks I should be talking to later in this week. Fingers crossed, don't want to jinx it, but Nina Hartley is a guest on this episode of the podcast. And as I said, I love the crisp, wintry fall air. And I love to sleep. This is why my electric bill is so damn high. I like to have the air conditioning on all the time. That is my only indulgence at night. In the winter, I have the fan on. In the fall, winter, fan, AC, if I can pull it off in the spring, summer. And I like to have the windows down, two comforters, the AC blowing on me all night so I get so cold I'm like a corpse. That is some of the best sleep ever. And it drives away germs and diseases. You don't need an asphyxiation bag. You know, the old nasty bag your grandmama would give you full of rotten eggs and garlic and old vegetables and other stinky things, peppers. And you put it around your neck when you get sick and it drives away spirits. You don't need that. You just need to have the air or the fan on your head. There's nothing that Chauncey DeVega cannot stand more, talking about myself in the third person, more that I can't stand than a house with the windows down, stinking up the place. You need to have air circulating. And I won't give a deep heart, and this is sincere, so I'm going to alter. Hold on. I'm scratching the flavor saver. This is how you know this is important, when I adjust the chair and scratch the flavor saver and get a swig of the Ooh, the manna from heaven. Look at it. Dionysius. He brought us wine. But then he came back and brought us Coca-Cola. I need a swig. Hold on. You can hear that glass hitting that glass, that metal hitting that glass, rather. Because the glass Coca-Cola, that's a whole nother thing that folks are not ready for. That's that Mexican Coca-Cola. It's like freebasing. You like Richard Pryor picking up lint and Coke off the floor, freebasing. And that JoJo Dancer movie and setting himself on fire. That's what Mexican Coca-Cola is. That's why our Mexican brothers and sisters got to watch out for diabetes. They drinking that Mexican Coca-Cola. And you ain't ready. Don't drink the Mexican Coca-Cola. You ain't ready for it. But I want to give a heartfelt congratulations to the one and only Ta-Nehisi Coates, MacArthur genius. This black man, Mr. Coates, doing his thing for the Atlantic on the regular. He stepped back a little bit to do his other work. Gets folks to pay for him to go to Europe and France. Talk about that smart hustle. 2 New York Times books. Finds out brothers hustling is going to write Black Panther, the comic book for Marvel. Then the following week, it comes out he's got the MacArthur Genius Award. Man, you are winning at life, Mr. Coates. I want to thank you. You are cool folk. Always been nice to the website. One of the first folks to put us on your blog roll at the Atlantic. And I remember the day I found that. I was like, well, wait a minute. Ta-Nehisi Coates put us on the blog roll? How cool is that? And emailed with him on occasion. He also congratulated him last night on Twitter. And I asked him, Ta-Nehisi Coates wins the MacArthur Genius Award. I said something like that. I turned to a rap lyric. Who's going to have that quotable? Would it be Biggie, Nas, GZA, or somebody else? And then he responded quite nicely and kindly. I guess he had just found out. He probably found out during the day, but he was still online offering up thank yous to folks who were sending him good love. And he quoted the great movie. I want to get it right. It's not Samurai Executioner. It came out here in this country, Shogun Assassin. Late 70s, early 80s. Called Lone Wolf and Cub. There you go. I had a 40-ish year old moment there where the engines were not firing on all cylinders. But Ta-Nehisi Coates, congrats, man. You are winning at life. And you earned the brass ring. Now, the question becomes, what does he do next? I mean, because see, this is a reason I'll never get a MacArthur Genius Award. Obviously, I'm not a genius. That's one. Two, I don't have the wonderful gifted insight that Coates has and other folk. I've met some of these MacArthur geniuses, and they're really smart. Imagine that. You get something in the letter, a phone call, say you're a genius, and here's $625,000, I believe. So I was thinking, if Chauncey DeVega ever got a genius award, what would I do with that money? And you go to the Atlantic, you can go to the MacArthur Foundation website, and they have a profile for all the winners and what they plan to do with the money. New York Times had an interesting story, too, and they're trying to figure out, is it like the lottery? You know, people win the lottery and they're miserable and go broke. What happens to the MacArthur Genius Award folk? And a lot of them just put the monies back into their own projects. A lot of folks already have enough money coming in from other sources. Money follows money. Some just pay off their student loans and live free of that anxiety. So I would take the first big hunk of money and pay off all my debts so I'd be solvent. I would buy my mother a home, buy her a new car, then I would go through my drawer of clothes and throw out all the socks and underwear with holes in it. And don't you judge, because I know you all out there got some holy underwear, too. I got different levels of holiness, by the way. Level 1, passable. Level 2, concern. Level 3, not too good. Don't wear them on a date. Level 4, that's when you deal with more butt cheek in other parts than you are fabric, and those go in the back of the drawer for an emergency when it's laundry day, or you just puttering around the house and you want to feel free. See, now we started a trend where I've been singing every episode. Last episode, it was that Madonna song. Now this episode, I'm doing the dun dun dun, and I also did I'm free. So I won't make you suffer through that anymore. Trust me, it's not going to be a fixture. It's just I'm in a good mood when I sing. I had a little special effects there. So what else would I do? I give some of my homeless folk I support some money. I surprise them that way. I go to, obviously, a financial advisor and 2 attorneys and then another advisor to see what options I have with the remaining amount to get some income coming in long term. I'd ask them how much I could take to play with. So I go to Vegas. I do my comic book. I keep hinting at it. Got it outlined. Gonna have to do the Kickstarter once we get some money together, because the Kickstarter should come at the end of a project, not at the beginning, folks. That's just a little hint for someone who knows folks who are actually going to be on the podcast working on that, who have successfully had a Kickstarter for their 2 or 3 at this point comic book projects. The Sun Brothers, cool people. What else would I do? Indulgent. I say socks. Oh, I'd probably go through my pants and my shirts and throw out anything or donate them to charity that don't fit. I'd stock up the refrigerator. I go to Price Costco or one of them places and get all that overpriced steak and meat where you think you're saving money. Ooh, I fill up a whole meat locker. I do that. I equip my zombie preparation backpack more. What else would I do? I'm not a very difficult person in terms of things that I want. I wouldn't buy a car because I think a car is a waste of money. What else? Maybe get a new big, big, big TV, them wraparound ones, a 3D capable smart TV. Yeah, maybe I'd do that. New computer, maybe. See, that's why I can't win this money, because I can't tell you beyond that what I would do. Email Chauncey DeVega. Email, brother, and tell me what you would do with that 625 large if you had the MacArthur Genius Award. And I'd do a documentary on professional wrestling. Something I've always wanted to do. And I put some money aside for my own intellectual endeavors. Because when you don't have stress, you can be super, super productive. Because you ain't worrying about bills. You ain't worrying about the phone ringing in the middle of the night. Mama DeVega, or Mama whoever, or Daddy DeVega, or Daddy whoever, or cousin, or brothers or sisters, or children asking you for money. You can do amazing things when you know you can come out of pocket to help them. But maybe that's why the money don't follow money. I'm pretty simple. Oh, and of course, I would have an enemies list that I keep. And I got this enemies list, you see. And I'd call up every doubter, every hater, everybody who wished me ill will, who said this wouldn't work, who said I would never get a MacArthur Genius Award, who mocked me, who cut off my success and productivity, who worked against me in nefarious ways. I'd call them up. And I get a t-shirt and some pants, custom made, that said MacArthur Genius Award winner. And I wear it all over town. And I'd be stuck, and I'd be strutting, styling, and profiling. And I'd have a cane and a hat, and I'd go up to random people and say, who am I? They'd be like, who are you? I say, I won a MacArthur Genius Award. What have you done? Send it out to the universe, man. But congratulations, Ta-Nehisi Coates. Man, he worked hard. And I just, Black Panther, I can't wait to read that. I'm sure he'll do a great job. He's not going to fall into the trap, I'm sure, where you got folks who get a creative project and they haven't worked in that genre extensively, graphic novels or comic books, and they totally poop the bed. He's too smart for that. I think he's too self-critical. So again, Ta-Nehisi Coates, much love to you. Other interesting stuff. Updating. So you'll see my stuff again on Salon, fingers crossed, on the regular. We're trying to aim for twice a week there, and then shows up on ChaunceyDeVega.com, a.k.a. Indomitable, in addition to the other work that's just exclusive to the site. So I am trying to still work through that balance. So I have a request for you folks. I know I ask so much. Don't I? You can yell at me. Yell at me through the your earbuds, your computer, your speakers, and be like, that Negro is always asking for things. Well, you know, I have my recurring request that folk rank and comment and review the podcast on iTunes. Now, folks are clicking. They're clicking on the reviews, but please write some comments, positive or negative, as long as they're from the heart. Both are worthwhile and useful. But as you see some of my stuff elsewhere, using Facebook more often, because that was a asset I ignored for too long to get our work out there. All the good, interesting, smart conversations we have here on ChaunceyDeVega.com, Indomitable, and the podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. So that's working better. Twitter, of course, because again, you guys circulate, use all your resources. But when you see one of my pieces, if you would, on Salon or Alternet, especially on Salon, because I know we got enough friends and fans here. I know you may have to log in. I don't think you have to sign up for a password, as long as you got Discuss. If you can't, go over there and comment there, and also comment on the main website, right? Because I think a lot of folk are commenting elsewhere, because I know the names, but comment on both if you would. Keep the conversation going. And if you can, you know, Facebook, tweet, Google Plus, all that good stuff on those websites, that helps to get us to the top 10 you see on the right-hand sidebar, and that creates opportunities. Like I said, fingers crossed, I'm talking to three interesting people this week, and none of that wouldn't have been possible if it wasn't for you guys, you know, sharing the website and all of our good work. Had that piece up there on Uncle Ben Carson. And you go to Salon. I put it up on the main site too. And read some of them comments. And I have a hypothesis. It's not an original one. It's not wholly mine. I'm sure I'm one of many people who's writing about it. One of the things I find so fascinating, because Black conservatives in the post-civil rights era, especially since the age of Reagan, they're not organic to the Black community. They are folks with people's hands up their behinds, like human minstrel puppets, and they're getting paid. They are professional tips of the spear for neoliberalism. I'll use an example. I talked to my great guest in a future upcoming episode about this, school privatization, which is not a good thing for Black and brown people, for poor people. The privatization neoliberal moment, you put a Black face on it, and that gives you some sort of moral authority. Then you go into the Black churches. Then you go into these communities. Then it's just how neoliberal governmentality works. Then you can have wholesale transfer of public resources to private interests who are actually working against the common good. and actually hurting black and brown folk. We have a lot of empirical data about these horrible charter schools. Never mind the origins of charter schools and the Jim and Jane Crow South as a reaction to school integration, these Christian freedom academies. Notice the language you hear today. Freedom, choice, common sense. There's a whole lot of history there. So read the comments whenever a black conservative is called out on their mess. So basically the title I would have picked for the Salon piece, and they do what they do. They're just smart people, but I would have called it Ben Carson has betrayed the black freedom struggle. Or even better yet, I would put race traitor colon, as I did at Indomitable. It would have been traitor colon, Ben Carson has betrayed the black freedom struggle. But hey, I can do whatever I want on my own site. Salon is cool enough to pick up that work. Handshake back and forth. We all nothing but love, and I appreciate them doing that. They'll go and denigrate black people. So some of the common deflections you've likely heard. Ex-black conservative is not like why black people. He or she is not on the Democratic plantation. Why are you going to hate on Ben Carson for thinking for himself and not being a dumb liberal? One of my other favorite ones was, and I laugh because I look at the comments because it's entertaining. Why do you hate on Ben Carson because he can think for himself? Yeah, he's thinking foolish thoughts. The claim has never been that black conservatives can't think for themselves. Yeah, the problem is they're not existing or standing and breathing in the air reality, empirical reality and truth. And they've decided to sell out their people for a bag of silver or gold to be human pets for white conservatives. They get that little pet on the head as human chaff. And I've said that about Herman Cain. That's how we rose to prominence. That's one of my high points of the last 10 or 20 years of life. Herman Cain trying to deflect and bob and weave Chauncey DeVega's insightful truth-telling about his Uncle Tom, tomfoolery. And then seeing it parodied on Fox News as they tried to call me. I ain't that stupid. I don't go into the devil's house. I'm not going to put my head into the lion's den unless it's on my own terms. And maybe down the road we can do the dance. But that Ben Carson, I'm going to read something for you before we get to this great conversation with Nina Hartley about the adult film industry. And she's so smart, by the way. This is not just about sex. Actually, we actually talk very little about porn and sex, believe it or not. We talk about feminism, gender, the religious right, secular humanism, metaphysics for a quick second, the body, yes, human sexuality, religious thinking and how religion damages the minds of so many folk, especially in terms of women and their sexual self-confidence and sense of self and identity. Just a wide-ranging conversation. She's a democratic socialist. Parents were involved in the civil rights movement. But we go where we may naturally. So Ben Carson, you may have seen this. You may have read this or seen this. Ben Carson apparently gave a speech to some Christian right-wing creationist group. I guess he's a Seventh-day Adventist, I think. I don't know if he disavowed him or he still is one. Whatever he is, he's a Christian fundamentalist. So he gave a speech to some group and the video has come up. Now, he's a smart surgeon, and I told folk this, and I don't know if you've experienced this. Doctors and surgeons especially are very, very smart people in a technical way. Some of them are true intellectuals, like any other group of folk, amazingly curious, widely read. But a lot of them, ones I've met, are technicians. And like any technician, just because you know how to do brain surgery, and just like any other area of life where you have high levels of expertise, just because you know how to cut somebody's brain open, like Ben Carson does, and operate on and do amazing things. Again, I don't know why he's sullying his legacy. Don't mean you're at all qualified to make any observations or insights about important matters of public concern, i.e. public policy. So you can believe whatever you want. Religious beliefs, as you know, I said, that's private business. You can believe in whatever fantastical supernatural being you want to. You can worship that red blood moon and howl at it if you want to, if that's a transcendent spiritual experience for you. You can go and think that Marvel comic books are the God's truth and you're going to live your life according to the edicts or tenets of Spider-Man. I don't care. But what concerns me is when you start thinking this stuff is empirical reality, that it trumps science, and that you can use your fantastical beliefs as the basis for legislation and violating the divide between church and state, that's when I got a serious problem. Believe whatever you want. Don't impose it on anybody else. Now, this is supposed to be a smart man. I'm sure he's smart in his own technical way. But as they say, my favorite movie, Casino, when De Niro is talking about that's one dumb white man about his nephew or nephew-in-law. No, it's not his nephew's an employee who's actually the nephew of the game commissioner or somebody like that. He's like, man, that's one dumb white man. So this is some compilations of quotes from this video. Now, this man is a scientist who apparently believes these things. And you ask me, in what country in the 21st century, developed country, that's supposed to be post-Enlightenment, or even product of the Enlightenment, that you can have people saying these things and be taken seriously for the highest office in the land? So these are some quotes culled from this videotape, right? Ben Carson. Now, just think about this foolishness. There's abundant evidence, geological evidence, that there was a worldwide flood. Go up into the Andes Mountains and see all these fossils on the top of those mountains. I mean, these things, when you talk to the evolutionists about them, they always say the same thing. Well, we don't understand everything. And I just say, I'm not sure you understand anything. You know, they look at all those layers, and then they find some fossils in one of those layers, or one of the layers, and they says, this fossil is this many years old because it's in this layer. So that means this fossil is like a million years old. And then later on they say, well, this layer is a million years old because this fossil, which is a million years old, is in it. You know, that's like saying, you know, the sky can be red or blue. And you say, well, the sky is blue. And you say, why is it blue? Because it is not red. Well, why is it not red? Because it's blue. Yeah, you know that's known as circular reasoning. That's how they explain the age of all these things. It's very circular reasoning, and really it has no real scientific validity. Then he continues later, you know, according to the theory of evolution, it, the I, had to go puke. I don't know what that was. P-U-K-H, exclamation mark. That's what it says here. And there was an eyeball overnight, just like that, because it wouldn't work in any other way. And when you ask the evolutionists about that, they say, well, we don't understand everything. And I say, well, I don't think you understand anything. Later on, he answers a woman's question. He says, I personally believe that this theory that Darwin came up with was something that was encouraged by the adversary. Apparently, adversary is their code word, these Christian fundy lunatics, for Satan. And it has become what is scientifically, politically correct. Amazingly, there are a significant number of scientists who do not believe it, but they are afraid to say anything. Okay. When you confront madness, you become mad and crazy yourself. Okay, I'm trying to calm down here. He doesn't understand Darwin. He doesn't understand theory of natural selection. Okay, let me calm down. This is a neuroscientist, by the way. He's talking about the devil and Satan tricking people into believing in evolution, which is one of the most widely researched. It's a fact. It's not a theory. It's a fact. Evolution is a fact. And I don't understand this thing about the fossils and millions of years. It's doublespeak. If you find a fossil that's dated to be a million years old, well, then one would have to assume, unless it came from outer space, that said fossil is from a planet that's at least a million years old. And I didn't think there was much debate about the age of the Earth. Several, 4.5, 5, 6 billion years old? Older? I'm not a geologist. See, I know when I don't know something, I admit it. Look it up. I can look it up and find out answers for us. But there you'd have somebody with that mouth-dropping level of ignorance and stupidity. I mean willful stupidity. And that's, again, an example of how religion can cloud the mind, especially fundamentalist religion. Now, I know I put an asterisk. There are many religions that are much more comfortable with science and branches of certain faiths that are much, much, much more comfortable with science. But my whole thing is, a man's a scientist. His whole career is a product of the scientific method and the enlightenment and rational thought. But he believes in magic. And not even persuasive magic. Yep, they're trying to have a tax code based off the Bible and tithing. And yet, he and Donald Trump, head of the GOP primary, that tells you it's a freak show clown car, and neither of them are going to make it, by the way. It's going to be an establishment candidate. Watch out, Jeb Bush. And speaking of Jeb Bush, either today or tomorrow, at Salon and then at chaunceyvega.com, I got some truth telling about Jeb Bush and his comments about free stuff. And my piece is called, Dear Jeb Bush, White People Really Love Free Stuff. Especially when they steal it from black and brown people. So we'll see how that gets truncated or edited down because it's too long. But that's the title is going to be on Indomitable, ChaunceyVega.com. So without further ado, hold on, because as I said, I'm sexy. This is a sexy, smart, interesting, entertaining podcast. And I slipped again, Freudian slip. I said, I'm sexy. Because what I'm doing is called positive reinforcement. Is I confront my decrepitude. I'm going to keep telling myself that I'm sexy. Even as I get older and as a man, my level of sexual energy and beauty and attraction to women, they're just not looking at me the same way. I'm too old. I need to get a Cadillac car or Mercedes or dress better or start wearing fake expensive watches. Or maybe I need to get a haircut more regularly. I'm going gray too fast. But that's my way of reinforcing that I'm still sexy. And so one more swig of Coca-Cola. Hold on before we get to Ms. Nina Hartley. Hold on. Ooh, that's good. So, as I said earlier, good, smart conversation, politics, race, the color line, pornography, democratic socialism, philosophy. And this is a long conversation that was edited down to about an hour or so. So me and Ms. Hartley will have to sit down again at a future date and hash out all the things we didn't get a chance to talk about that I wanted to talk about in this episode. So one word, one note. For careful listeners, so she and I talk, and about 40 minutes in, you'll hear a slight change in the audio, and that's because the signal was dropped, and we're having some connection issues because of Skype weather. And I said, no, I want to keep this going. I want to figure this out tomorrow. So I ended up having to call her back and we had to record on the phone. So that explains sort of the varying quality there. Skype was acting up. So it's good audio, not as pristine as I would prefer. But next time she and I sit down, it's going to be perfect as can be. And hopefully when she comes through Chicago, she and I can do an interview face to face, sit down and bring the microphone, the computer, and just go back and forth and have a wonderful, wonderful salon. But I want to thank her for taking the time out of her busy schedule to chat. Good conversation with Nina Hartley. Without further ado, in this, the next segment of the eponymous, I didn't give in. I'm not giving it to that grammar demon. The eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show.
This land is your land, and this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, and I saw above me that endless skyway, I saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me.
I always like to ask folks, how have you been and what have you been up to?
I've been overall okay. Mom's getting older and all that. So there's, I'm a half a sandwich generation, meaning I have an aging parent, but I have no children. Luckily, I have a wonderful doctor sister who has taken the lead for the siblings on caring for mom. So mom's in a good place. It's just the fact that she's 89, what can you do?
Wow.
My wonderful niece is going off to college, so that part's good. Business is mixed. My persona is doing well, but the business has, changed from what it was when I came up, and I'm still scrambling to find my best purchase in this new landscape. Branch out from what I do, which is have sex on camera and talking about sex, to mainly talking about sex to people who will pay for that, students and doctors and things of that nature. So sex, sexuality, sexual expression are always what I do. So, sexual freedom is my raison d'etre, and so that will never stop.
It's funny, I was thinking about, secular humanism and the role of sexual freedom and liberty and feminism.
Mm-hmm.
And humanism more broadly, and looking at the human zoo, I got a whole bunch of stuff I have, about Donald Trump and our current politics. And some of the things that you're just hearing, it sounds like you're out of the 18th century. He's a clown, and I feel so bad in the sense that Ben Carson has so sullied his name and his reputation as a brain surgeon.
I remember reading his book when he was younger. It's like, wow, what a story to overcome all that, to be that, and then to go here? Oh, geez.
It's that old adage, you don't necessarily hire an electrician to fix your plumbing.
Right. Yes. I would hire him to fix my child's brain, and that is it.
And as I said, it's a spectacle, and we can laugh at it at a certain level, but it's deadly serious.
Yeah.
His observation, he's not the only one of these conservatives. We can talk about the religious right and politics more broadly, of course. I heard him say that the problem isn't with women, it's the things inside of women.
There's no war on women. There may be a war on what's inside of women, which I think he was. So that can be taken two ways. So on his version of it, the war on what's inside women are the abortion rights people. So we people who believe in reproductive justice are making a war on what is inside women, i.e. defenseless little babies. We on the opposite side of that fence hear that statement and go, yeah, from you motherfuckers. And I'm just talking about this the other day. Obviously I came of age during, I was 14 when Roe v. Wade was decided. And even though I had not even kissed a boy at that time, I just knew that it was momentous, because until or unless a woman has control over her fertility, she cannot be equal and free to men, free and equal to men. It cannot be, especially since we are sexual beings too, and all of that. So my feminism very much comes from the whole birthing rights movement, the natural birth movement of the late 60s, early 70s, and that's when I realized that, helping women claim that experience for themselves in a healthy way would be my life's work. Then I sort of got expanded into sex, because it turned out that sex and babies are related.
They are. It's an amazing surprise.
Crazy, right? I know. Wow. And because my queerness, I'm so queer that sex expression was the first thing. I needed to be public about it. If I wasn't exhibitionistic enough for porn or considered pretty enough for porn, I would have been a nurse midwife with an active, kinky personal life, but, you know, supporting where it's at. But still, the idea that my body is mine is the foundation of what it is I do and what it is I teach. And that goes toward, of course, reproductive justice. And I'm really uncompromising in that. I used to think that anti-abortion people didn't like abortion because they hated women. And I realized that I don't believe that anymore for the most part. I do believe that they believe that it's murder. So if I think something is murder, if I think the death penalty is murder, I have to agitate against the death penalty, right? If I truly believe in my moral soul that the death penalty is murder, I have to do what I can to abolish the death penalty. So if I really think that abortion is murder, then I have to do all I can to stop abortion. And the vessel, i.e. the woman, is secondary in my thinking. I don't agree with that. And so I have a question for you, Mr. DeVega.
Absolutely. Chauncey, please. Chauncey. I'll take the honorific, okay. But we're friends at the virtual bar, so right. Chauncey's always good.
I have a question. I've never been able to get this satisfactorily answered. So the rules against sexual commerce, the rules against abortion, are based on religious ideas about what is right and wrong for women's bodies and the place of marriage and all of that. So they come from a very strong religious foundation of what is to be in the world. So why hasn't anybody fought against the anti-abortion rules on religious freedom grounds? My religion does not say that there is a soul. My religion does not say that killing a pre-viable fetus is murder. For me, as a nurse and as a human, you know, until the baby can breathe on its own, it's a parasite. It's my body still. So why can't that be an argument against punitive abortion and anti-birth control rulings? It's like, you don't want an abortion, don't have one. My religion doesn't say that to me, so I have to live under your religion?
Well, the simple answer, I mean, going back to the idea of the spectacle and the human zoo that is contemporary right-wing politics, a few weeks ago at the Fox News Republican human zoo debate, as I called it, you had people who are supposed to be rational, and they clearly are not in many ways, standing on a stage talking about God, coming to them and telling them to run for office.
Right, right.
And that being taken as a legitimate answer. Now, in any other context, if somebody on the street said they hear invisible voices that tell them to go and pursue public office to accrue power, they'd lock them up. So your perspective on religion and mine and others, folks who are secular humanists, folks who may not be right-wing Christian fundamentalists, because that's the other move that they've pulled, is they monopolize the idea of religion to mean right-wing Christian evangelical faith.
Yes.
And their other ideological move that the corporate media and the right-wing media is complicit with is they've redefined America as a theocracy.
Right?
This is not a theocracy. They are the American version of ISIS. And they want to use, and they've done this, Citizens United, the Hobby Lobby decision, for example, and others, where they're breaking down the wall between church and state, and they're really radicals. They're not conservatives. So they're violating their own principles.
I'm looking at Trump and seeing how well he's doing so far. You know, I used to tell people, you know, culture gets the pornography it deserves. So that's why so much of American porn is just stupid. Most of it is just made by people raised in America with their own weird ideas about sex. And we get the politics we deserve. And I just don't know how to get money out of politics. So in Canada, they have a three-month election cycle, and they have spending limits. I think they're going to spend $40 million for the whole election. So Citizens United was a disaster, but I don't know how to get money out of politics.
Well, as folks have said to me who are far smarter, here's my suggestion. You probably have flirted with this. The best way to become rich in America is, if you're an African-American, Latino, Native American, or other person of color, is to become a conservative and to hate your own people.
Yes.
Or if you're a woman, become an anti-feminist, or if you're gay, hate gay people.
Yeah.
So you could engage in a radical act of reinvention, almost like is performance art, and basically become a conservative and fleece them for all their money.
Oh my God, but I think my face would fall off.
Personal integrity, right?
Right. Well, there's that, and then there's, you know, the last 31 years of my life have been a lie, absolutely a lie. Yeah, I don't think so. It's not going to work. But yes, I can't be that cynical. So I don't know which I hate more, the idea that they really believe this, or the idea that they're just craven opportunists who are trying to play to the cheap seats and don't believe any of it. I don't know which is worse.
And I was actually talking to my mother the other day, and I think she's right about this. She's in her mid-70s now, product of the South. And we often joke about Rush Limbaugh, right? And I have no doubt, and this isn't slander, so he can't sue me. I don't have any money that he can take anyway. think about the hypocrisy of these conservative right-wing media personality types, their opinion leaders. I have no doubt, my mother and I are joking about this. My mother's always like, she's like, it'll be next week or in a few months, but at some point they're going to find Rush Limbaugh with a bunch of kiddie porn or with a dead body in the trunk of his car. That there's just something so scurrilous about the man. And the more you complain and the more you hate, usually the more you demagogue, it's really about yourself. I mean, the most blatant homophobes very often are closeted gay men.
So the idea that when he came out of the drug addict, that didn't hurt his ratings at all. I think partly it's also this death cry of the shrinking, soon-to-be white minority. And they just, the displacement, the cognitive dissonance of the world I'm living in now versus the world that was fed to me in the 50s is so great, they just can't keep their sanity together. The idea that America is changing, the idea that America is an empire in decline, that we have hollowed it out from the inside, really starting from Reagan, but, it's taken 35 years, but the vertical transfer of wealth is pretty well complete, and mm-hmm. the right wing very much has a lock on the state house. I don't think a Republican will ever get national office again, but they have, when I read what they've done, they've made laws against bringing suit against gun makers. They've made, they try to make laws against birth control because it's abortifacient. It just leaves me slack-jawed in amazement that they can show their faces in public for being emotionally manipulative, intellectually dishonest, and again, politically craven in their search for power. That they all need to go to a monastery for a year and in silent contemplation.
It was written about years ago. Folks always talk about Richard Hofstadter's paranoid style in American politics, but even before then, there was a really powerful book. I always forget the author's name. He's one of the founding fathers of modern political science, and it's basically called Psychopathology in American Politics. And he outlined, in the 40s and 50s, a lot of the right-wing, infantile, paranoid impulses we're seeing today because, yes. It's so wonderful to talk to you, number one, about, you've continually reinvented yourself. Sex and sexuality and what we'll call biopolitics, they're central to politics and the polis and the public sphere.
Oh, yes.
And so much of the right-wing narrative about sex, about womanhood, about personhood, is a deep anxiety and fear of women's bodies and also women's pleasure. And I don't think that gets talked about enough. There's a deep anxiety about women being self-sufficient and also being sexually able to please themselves.
There's a great saying from the French that I wish I could say it in French, but it translates roughly to, when prostitutes unite, powerful men tremble. So what I, when I'm in my nice middle class lady, now of course my sexual threat on the surface has dimmed some because I'm no longer young and beautiful. I'm not 25 to 35 years old. So I'm now fully middle aged. I'm 56 years old. I'm fully middle aged person. I could have a 35 year old child, God forbid. The terror and the vitriol that comes at a woman who dares to stand up and claim her sexuality is still as great now as it was in the 17th century because again, going back to the freaking Bible and the idea that, women should be subservient, et cetera, et cetera. The idea that women are not chattel slaves. We claim to hate what the folks in ISIS are doing to women, but on a scale of 1 to 10, with 0 being full actual equality for the genders, for all genders, and 10 being ISIS and what they think of as morality, the American religious fanatics, there are 2 or 3. The notion that women's sexuality is either non-existent, pure, and passive, or voracious, and of course the other side of the coin is women's sexuality is voracious and dangerous.
Predatory
and have to be controlled is, again, all stems back to the Abrahamic religion. So you have a pastoral situation and a pastoral God, and so we have women are chattel, women are there to be fruitful and multiply because the harsh religion for a harsh land. And the idea that women are fully sexual beings has always been the other side of the coin. As above, so below. You cannot have a one-sided coin. So as soon as you create the virgin, you have to create the whore. And so years ago, my first husband said, you'll have to wear the label whore as a badge of honor. And I said, sure, because as soon as I heard about the idea in the 70s of, again, the new women's scholarship about looking at the old stories from a pagan, pre-Christian idea, the idea of the sacred prostitute made my little 12-year-old ears go, really? That's me. That's what I want to do. That is my calling, some kind of healing. And so going from the Berkeley in the 60s, where I discovered, was exposed to Reikian therapy, primal screen therapy, bioenergetic, massage therapy, Tai Chi, naked Tai Chi, guided mescaline therapy. I mean, it was all there. So, and my own injuries, psychic injuries, I realized that our pain is felt in the body, it's held in the body, it can be healed through the body. Presto, bingo, change-o, pleasure is, of course, transformative. Pleasure is an altered state of consciousness. The Puritans who think that the, you know, idle hands are the devil's playground, pleasure for its own sake, it must be bad because that is what their religion says. So any woman who espouses pleasure for its own sake, has pleasure on her own terms and offers pleasure to men, has to be suspect. At the same time, if you look at the history of prostitution back in, late medieval, early Renaissance Europe, the prostitutes were regulated by the church as a necessary evil, so that men would not slake their horrible lusts on their pure, pure wives. Better to go with a woman already tainted and fallen than to debase their children's mother with their horrible lusts. So the whole idea that the body is an enemy to spirituality is something that has always confounded me and fascinated me. Because the most scary thing a woman can say to a man is, sure, sounds fun. And I do that to guys, and they just go, because they're expecting pushback. They're expecting, ew, that's nasty. They're expecting me to behave a certain way, and I say, that sounds like a fun time. Let's do it. And they just don't know how to take a yes.
You know, you said something really interesting there, sort of these paradoxes and tensions, right? So on one hand, I had Roz DeShivo, who's a professional sex educator based out of Massachusetts, Boston. Mm-hmm. And she and I chatted a few months ago, and I'm, again, you want to understand others, but there's, again, the classic problem in metaphysics and philosophy is, you know, number one, do other people exist?
Right.
You can't, there's no fundamental proof for that. And trying to understand the lived experiences of other people. And as I was sharing with her, and I said, you know, my mother doesn't listen to the podcast, so I have no shame, and I'm sure she'd probably yell at me for sharing her personal business. But I was raised in a very sex-positive home. I was not raised in a really religious background. My father tried to drag us to church, you know, on big holidays, but I renounced religion when I was probably 11 or 12. I'm an atheist, quoting Frank Schaefer, who believes in God. I'm a secular humanist. So it's really hard for me, based on my upbringing, to try to understand people who have sexual guilt, especially guilt or anxiety that's based in religion, and I know some of these folk. I discognitively, I don't understand
it.
Thank you.
Yeah, right? I don't get it.
What's your advice for dealing with these folks?
I couldn't fall in love with a religious person because I have religious friends. I do. One of my close friends is a believing Christian. She believes she'll see her family again in heaven. But our agreement is I don't talk her off of God and she doesn't talk me on to God because that would be a dead end. We would not go anywhere. I don't get it. I don't understand it. I was 8 years old and I remember thinking this is all bullshit. My parents did not try to relate. We did not have a religious tradition in our family. We had a little Hanukkah, a little Christmas, a little Passover, a little Easter. But I was 21 before I understood that Easter. Well, I knew Easter was a big deal for Christians. I wasn't, and I knew that Christ was risen again and all that. So I don't understand religion at all. I don't get it. Because for me, as a, I'm a, not only am I a secular humanist and I'm a raging atheist, I also am biological scientist. And so the quick and dirty thing, the three parts of the brain, you have the brain stem, aka the lizard brain. Feed, fight, fuck, flee, flog. Just to sheer keep the organism with water, oxygen, and food and mating. That's all it does. Has no thinking. You lay the eggs, you walk away, whatever happens, happens. Then the next thing to evolve millennia or millenniums ago was the midbrain, aka the mammalian brain. And in that is all the feeling parts, the amygdala, the hippocampus, memory, love, hate, bonding, compassion, empathy, feelings, love, feelings, bliss, union, awe. Those are just physiological brain states that the body can, that can be achieved through stimulation of the body. You can trigger these states by sleep deprivation, drug use, pleasure, davening, crawling on your knees up a hill to see the Virgin Mary in a tree stump, whatever. So the state of awesomeness is a physiological state that most brains, and people who are not autistic, can reach. It's just something that human brains are meant to do because before speech, we had to be able to communicate. So emotions are designed to be contagious. That's their job. The eyes are the window to the soul because the eyes go straight to the middle of the brain. And then that pesky forebrain, that analytical thinking. So, quote-unquote, spiritualness is a human state. Religion is man-made. So
that's right.
The forebrain says it has to tell stories. That's what it does. It has to make a story about what these feelings mean, air quotes around the word mean. You know, why did the rain come? Why did the earthquake happen? Why did the volcano go? We need to feed them a virgin or whatever. So for me, I'm comfortable with the idea that we can't know everything. I am a materialist, meaning dialectical materialist, so I do believe that we eventually can know most things. But there also is going to be something that we don't know, and that's okay with me. I don't need to call it God.
I have to ask the obvious question as I'm smiling here. Have you ever had a moment of ecstasy in your professional life or personal life where you had to make a Hegel or Kant joke about dialectical materialism?
You know what? So funny you asked me about that. So funny. So I grew up, in a secular household. My parents were seekers, though, and they discovered Zen Buddhism when I was 10 and became very devoted followers of it. They were ordained. My father stayed in until he died a couple years ago. My mother is still there. So, you know, Zen Buddhism, aura. My mother has a new book out called Seeds for a Boundless Life by Zen K. Blanche Hartman, which is a collection of her lectures and stories. So, you know, I come from that place, but I myself never understood God at all. I totally understand that man created God. So years ago, I just left my first marriage, and I had been really unhappy for a long time. I was having a wonderful, mad, crazy affair with a friend from high school. Just awesome, just overwhelming. And I'm with him one afternoon, and I'm filled with a sensation that is so complex and expansive and intuitive and insightful that even in the middle of it, I recognize, oh my gosh, if I had a God story, this sensation, this moment right now that I'm living in right now is what people are trying to say, which this moment is when people use the word, God healed my heart, Jesus saved me, God entered my heart, this is the sensation they're trying to describe. But I don't have a God story. So I knew that it was a physiological brain state that I had gotten to that allowed me to have that release. And I even, you know, I don't know what you know about poetry, but haiku, my father wrote haiku, and he said, you don't write haiku, you take dictation. And so in that moment, a haiku was born. And would you like to hear it?
Absolutely.
So in that moment, while I'm having this experience that I recognize if I was a Gentile, I'd say, oh, God's in the room. Oh, Jesus healed me. And here, heart cracked open, I spilled over into myself. How wonderful.
I like that. That's T-shirt or bumper sticker worthy. That's my supreme compliment. I say put it on a T-shirt.
So I have had the experience. So like when I talk to people who are truly God believers and are not hating on me, I do understand as much as I can being a non-spiritual person. I don't have a spiritual practice. I try to honor sexuality always, and when I'm with somebody, always to try to be helpful and of service. So that part of it, try to keep my ego out of it as much as possible and be of service to other people, because as a nurse, my job is to help you into yourself. My job is to help you with your life. Luckily, I have a nice partner at home, so I have my life taken care of at home as well, so I don't need to vampirize other people's emotional states. The best we can hope for is keeping religion out of daily life, but we're doing a very poor job of it because, again, religious belief color all the sexual commerce laws. Religious belief colors all of the consensual drug use laws. And I'm not a libertarian. Why on earth would Republicans block jobs programs for roads and bridges that will bring jobs, middle-class jobs, to areas that cannot be outsourced? Why? Do they hate Obama that much? Are they that much of racist assholes that they can't even say, wait, in my district, people could have jobs building bridges and fixing roads. Yes, I shall vote for that program. What is going on with that?
So it's so much going on there. I mean, so Grover Norquist famously said, the idea is to make the government so small you can drown it in a bathtub. So you have a departure starting probably in the 80s. With Reagan, but certainly in the 90s after the end of Clinton, where it's the end of normal politics. So the Republicans are no longer functioning as a rational, reasonable political organization that wants to intelligently allocate resources. They're a cult, and they're beholden to extreme libertarianism and racism. But you said something earlier about sort of the idea of ecstasy, right? Because the biological part is so interesting, because the more that we know about neuroscience, we know that we can create hallucinations by stimulating certain parts
right,
of the brain.
Right?
False memories
yes.
are easy to create.
Yes.
And there's a lot of good sociologists, political psychologists, who are doing work that basically demonstrates that conservatives and liberals, we'll use that language, our brains function very differently.
Yes.
So folks who are more authoritarian, Republican, they're binary thinkers, they're single-minded,
right.
they are hyper-focused, and they're fascinated by things that scare them. It's this odd repellence between fascination and loathing. Yeah. And that produces a certain understanding of politics, because going back to the intersection of sex, pleasure, and politics, like, you listen to a lot of this rhetoric, the anxiety about women, fear of female sexuality, go down the list. But there's also a deep fascination. Thinking about, what do they call those things, the vaginal probes they want to give women?
The transvaginal ultrasounds?
Yeah, there's a huge dildo. They're virtually and literally raping women with this thing, and to them, somehow they reconcile it with love of women. It's perverse.
It's infantilizing women. So if we could just show them that the real baby, she'd change her mind. But women have always sought to end unwanted pregnancies, going back to the dawn of time. It's just, that's how it is. They used to do it by exposure. They'd have the baby and leave it to die. Back before the witch trials, because most of the women who were burned as witches were actually midwives.
Were feminists or gay or had land that people wanted?
Well, they're also midwives and healers. And so the beginning of the professionalization of medicine, men. So women had a lot of knowledge, had a lot of power in the community, and they had to get rid of that. Plus widows with property, plus, you know, menopausal women who were scary to look at. So all that. Barbara Ehrenreich wrote a great book years ago that was my early feminist books called For Her Own Good, 150 Years of Doctors' Teachings to Women. And it's just enough to make the top.
Barbara Ehrenreich, who wrote Nickel Denied?
Yes, yes. Anything she writes on women is amazing. And also Merlin Stone, When God Was a Woman, was very influential to me when I was growing up. So yeah, so there is the binary thinking. Are you familiar with the writer Carol Queen?
The name is familiar.
You should definitely have her on the podcast. So she wrote an amazing book called Real Live Nude Girl, Chronicles of a Sex Positive Culture. It's an essay collection. She's just so smart. It just makes me smart to read her. And one of her essays is The New Absexuality. So she coined the word absexuality, abduct, to take away from, ab, as adductors bring your limbs into your body, and your adductors take your limbs away from your body. She was talking, watching a woman in an anti-pornography lecture, going down and reading a list of titles. And Carol watched her in the audience, where the woman was clearly becoming excited. Just, you know, the breathing and the heart rate and the flush in the skin. And Carol had an epiphany that this woman is excited but doesn't know it. So an absexual, i.e. most of the Republicans, they get their sexual excitement through being horrified, through being scandalized, through being disgusted, through being just completely, it's abhorrent. Look at it more. So if you and I don't like something, you and I don't look at it. We look at things we like to look at. But they revel in it. They marinate themselves in their disgust and in their horror and in their indignation and in their righteous indignation. They live there because it's so, oh my God, look at this, look at this, look at this. And it's like, you don't even know how excited you are right now. And it's absolutely Republicans in a nutshell. They cannot live and let live because they cannot handle subtlety, and they have a difficult time handling nuance. You know, you're a Christian, you're not a Christian, you know, up, down, right, wrong, whore, a saved, unsaved, virgin, whore. But the religion really gets very sick, of course, is the concurrent infantilizing of women.
This purient fascination, but also repulsion, and these Duggars are just, again, perfect example number one about sort of sexually maladaptive behavior.
Yeah.
But in their public, they're going to be even more popular afterwards because it's a Christian redemption of falling and then resurrection. They're going to love these people even more.
And the poor wife's going to have to take a lot of the burden. So, yes, he sinned. He was a hypocrite. But somehow he wouldn't have done it if she had been more supportive. She'd either been offering him sex when he wanted it or helping him shoulder the stress of the whole molestation story. So these women, they're given no information about their bodies or sex and then told it's the most beautiful thing in the world that you're going to share with someone you love. They go into marriage completely ignorant. They don't know what things are called, where they're located, how they work, what they're supposed to do, and now keep your man happy. It just boggles the mind. It's feminist in me. While I could never be a shaved head separatist feminist, I understand some of that rage. I understand black rage better, you know, because I come from a background of civil rights activists going to back to the South.
Now, was it your parents or grandparents who were freedom riders or who were activists?
No, my grandfather. Your father? My mother is an Alabama. My mother's family are Alabama Jews. My grandfather, Joe Gelders, was a civilian supporter working for the release of the Scottsboro Boys. So he was a secular Jew in Alabama, and he was an early convert to socialism when he read Pillars of Socialism. At the time in the 30s, only socialism was preaching race equality as a foundational concept, that the races are equal. And so that, my grandfather is a very fair-minded person, that really spoke to him. So he, the Klan burned crosses on my mother's lawn when she was a little girl because her father was a, you know, Jewish commie and lover. Her mother was second generation. Pete Seeger used to stay at their house when he would come through the South picking up folk songs. So I grew up going to anti-war marches, civil rights marches. You know, I met Huey Newton and his wife at the Zen Center. As much as a Caucasian person can have a vague understanding of the struggle, I'm not bad for a white chick. That's all I will say that much. But I've also known that the struggle takes a long time, and the women's rights movement, we're still fighting that. We're still fighting, you know, for, I'm a believer in universal, you know, single-payer health care. So answer me this, two things. Okay, so going back to libertarians, being an anti-abortion libertarian, it's like in my body. And also, how can you be an anti-legal commercial sex trade and be libertarian? You're not libertarian. You're just a Christian masquerading as a libertarian because you don't like taxes.
The praxis there is this idea, we believe in a balance between positive and negative liberty. Libertarians, in their worst instances, the juvenile college student who comes for money, who hates the government but is a trustafarian, they believe that the government is always their enemy. But they don't realize on a macro level sense that the state actually created their opportunities. And a lot of it is veiled racism and sexism, where they don't want any intervening power who can limit their freedom to discriminate and mistreat others. I mean, that's really what I've had students like this. And when I talk to these students, I tell them, your rights as a privileged white guy do not extend to your ability to deny women, people of color, or anybody else their rights and liberties. Your rights don't trump our rights. And for a lot of them, it's an epiphany because they've never thought about that.
Wow. They hate the government until they need FEMA. I mean, I think what the chart is, as a general rule, red states receive more aid than they give in taxes.
And they also have the highest rates of porn consumption.
Yes, and
as well.
Teen pregnancy and divorce and all that.
And drug use.
You'd think that the hypocrisy alone would just shut them up.
But I just want to pivot for a second, going back to where we started, because I said, you know, you have so much to offer. So we're talking about race on the color line, and one of the things I write a lot about, think a lot about, is popular culture. And I've grappled with this back and forth, because the porn industry, however we want to define it, is a reflection of a given culture and society, right? It's going to change from country to country. The problems you see in a society, you're going to see in its popular culture. Do you think that the adult film industry, thinking back as a historian, because you're also a historian, too, I don't know if you bracket your own identity that way, but your knowledge about sex and sexuality, American history, and the adult film industry and sex work is just impressive. And I've listened to a lot of your interviews over the years. Do you think that the adult film industry has been an aid or a hindrance to racial and social progress more generally?
That's another two-edged sword. I'll tell you why. On the one hand, if you look at regular popular culture, maybe not the last much, a couple of years, a woman always had to be punished for crossing whatever line she crossed, right? So a woman in popular culture, if a woman crosses a sexual line, she has to lose her life, her job, her sanity, her child, her mate. Something bad has to happen. She has to pay. So
the transgression is punished.
Right, exactly. So now, and then, of course, the black man can never have the white woman. So Angelina Jolie, you know, falls in love with Denzel Washington in Bone Collector, but he's a quadriplegic and can never fuck her. So she's safe. So she can love, you know, she can love the wounded black man who can never actually put his black penis into her white vagina. And we can say, oh, isn't that moving forward because they're colorblind? So on one hand, plenty of interracial couples in America, right? And so pornography is the only place where interracial couples with a African-American male and a Caucasian female can see couples like themselves having sex. On the other hand, the rare exception of Shawn Michaels and a couple others, almost all of the interaction, of course, are stereotypical. How many times have I been with an escaped convict? I always play those ones for laughs, as in yuck, yuck, nudge, nudge, wink, wink. So some people love the interracial thing because it's transgressive. Other people want to watch it because my husband's black and I want to see a white woman fuck a black guy and kiss him on the mouth because I kiss in my scenes. And on the other hand, the stereotypical roles that the black guys have to play, that hasn't hardly advanced at all. I thought when Obama came in, we'd see more black guys in suits. That's only now beginning to happen. Some of the younger black men in porn will not play thugs, will not play gangsters will not play escape convicts. They on camera. They own suits, and they will come to work in a suit and a tie to play that guy, which I really appreciate. Two steps forward, one step back. Yes, it is very common now to see interracial couples, but interracial almost. But the racism persists in that the interracialness of it is almost what I racial. Everyone understands it's black man, white woman. It's not Hispanic woman, white guy. It's not Asian woman, black guy.
Yeah, and Asian men are almost never seen in mainstream American corporate porn.
There's only one. There's only one Anglo-Asian actor in porn, a handsome, hunky, muscular Brit whose name completely escapes me now. I cannot believe that because he's so hot. I would just love to work with him. So for me, I work with black people because I just don't, you know, I work with anybody that I like because people say, Nina, do you like black men? It's like, I like people. I've hurt. And if I don't like you, it doesn't help. I don't fetishize race.
But thinking about where we started, you know, you mentioned technology there and the internet. So, you know, we were talking before we formally sort of got things going, getting our timing about, so we met on Twitter, right? Went back and forth. The internet machine made our connection possible. But thinking about, again, how stardom has changed. So has social media and the internet, has that been an aid or a help in terms of adult film stars maintaining their mystique, or has it taken it away? Because back in the day, you couldn't email or tweet someone whose work you admired on the big screen. Now, all of a sudden, these folks are instantly accessible, and I don't care if they're in sports or politics or elsewhere. Has that been a good thing or a bad thing in your experience?
For me personally, who likes contact with their fans and who wants to get my message out there, it's been a good thing. The internet, having decimated my business, was a bad thing, but the business model where you waited around for a company to hire you, that made it more difficult for people who are alt to come in, you know, if you were older or bigger or tattooed or anything like that, made it more difficult to get hired because the people who own the companies are idiots, for the lack of a better word, are for the most part quite conservative, straight white guys who don't understand alt sexuality at all, and they're threatened by it, just like your regular American dude. But you don't forget, most people in porn up until recently were not artists or sexual revolutionaries or philosophers or very political. They were just people making a buck and get seats and titties. The idea behind most of the big companies of the 80s and early 90s were just, honestly, a lot of meatheads. You know, I say that with, you know, full affection, but just dudes with no clue about anything. So the internet has made it possible for niche players, going back to Marx, now because of the internet, because of digital media, the workers can own the means of production. You have an iPhone, you have a camera, you have a computer, boom, you can make movies. What they don't own, of course, is the means of distribution, and that is the broadband. That is the actual airwaves themselves, which are still owned by media conglomerates, and then banking. So we don't have censorship, something that would be worth a investigative piece. We don't have censorship by government because content-based prohibitions against pornography have almost always been shot down as unconstitutional. You know, as long as there's no minors, deaths, animals, blood, and poop, nothing is otherwise illegal. But if you have, with the internet, I can broadcast myself and get out there. If I'm willing to work, if I'm an entrepreneurial young, ambitious and hardworking young person, I can get my thing out there and find my audience who will sustain me for my life. Because some of my fans I've had for 30 years.
You were in, you know, thinking about how the business has changed, a little history, social history lesson here. Because as you said, you know, you have technology can be an aid and a hurt. Technology puts some people out of work and makes some types of practice obsolete and empowers others. But technology, as you said, you know, if other folks control the means of distribution, but if technology can also be a way, I'm thinking Uber is a great example of this, where you have these new technologies that supposedly empower people to make work, but in doing so, you're destroying people who are taxi drivers and taking away their livelihood, while you have another big company that runs Uber making all the money while the Uber drivers are getting paid nothing, really, if you think about all their expenses. Technology has decentralized. And you were in the great, one of my favorite movies, and should have won the Oscar, Boogie Nights. How accurate was the film? I mean, what was it like to be on the set? And how did we get from a point where you actually had people using film and actually trying to make, you know, real films, albeit of varying quality, that's sure, for sure, to sort of the digital industry of today?
I understand Boogie Nights, first and foremost, is a Hollywood movie. So it's the director's idea of that time and the director's idea of that world. And he got a couple things right and the rest of it was like completely wrong. It should never have been about a dude because women have always driven porn. John Holmes notwithstanding, porn's about pussy. Because in our culture, we have, because of the culture, we have created a false pussy scarcity. And yet, because of the cultural constraints about sluts, air quotes around the word slut, and men's both fascination with and fear of a sexually autonomous woman, we have created the sense that there isn't enough, and also enforced monogamy, a culturally enforced monogamous behavior. We have created the idea, and for a lot of men, I don't get enough sex. There is a shortage of sex. I hate women because they're not giving me pussy. But if she gives it to me too easily, then I can diss her for being a slut, and I can then off-put my discomfort over her willingness to have sex with me onto her and make it her problem that she's having sex with me. The movie Boogie Nights is strictly a 100% Hollywood movie. It was fun. I had a great time making it. I was treated well on the set. William H. Macy is the most lovely gentleman you could ever hope to meet. He's a real nice guy. And yet, it was nothing was real about it. So I came in, 84 was the hot birth of video and the cold death of film. So I've only made about 10 on-film projects. Everything else has been video. You know, the problem with video is that anybody can make a movie. But on the good side, anybody can make a movie. So the video did allow for other ideas to slowly start seeping in, but it wasn't until the digital distribution model that the alt pornography can come in. There are all kinds of people now who could never have been hired because you're too androgynous, you're too fat, you're too queer, you're too tattooed. So now there are more kinds of people who can make porn, there are more kinds of people who can find their audience, and that's great. But if they do censorship by banking, which is a real thing, or they do censorship by not carrying adult material on this particular platform, then we're back to square one.
There's so much genius insight in sharing there, but two things I just want to try to double back to very quickly. Part of the joy of doing the podcast is obviously the interesting, smart folk who are kind enough to sit down and chat and go back and forth. It's one of the reasons I started it, one of the reasons we sustain it. But you said something about not being the same. You're a better lover now than you were in your 20s, 30s, 40s.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of, obviously, we can talk about sex education in this country, and in America as a society that's fascinated by sex but immature about sexuality.
Right.
I mean, that's huge tension. But what do you think, as you age in life, and as we hopefully become more mature, more wise, more sensitive, why do you think some folk become better lovers as they age and other folks don't? And what do you think, or why do you think you're a better lover now than you were when you were in your 20s or late teens?
The basic answer is hopefully with age comes maturity, insight, relaxing of, you know, experience, being able to understand other people better. So I'm better at sex now because A, I've had more of it. But more importantly, I've been present. I really use sex. For me, I've used sex as my meditation. I try to be fully present for sex, try to get my ego out of it, try to really learn how to let my body lead and show my partner respect. And that just takes practice. It's like driving or dancing or shooting or any, it, you know, sex is, among other things, a physical skill set. And so the more you get to do a thing, how does my body work? What does my body like? What turns me on? What turns me off? What attracts me? What repels me? Oh, I get it. Where does my sexuality deviate from what the society says I'm supposed to want? And where does it go ahead? Where does it align with what the society says I'm supposed to want? So just self-awareness and knowledge, and hopefully just sheer experience. And I've gotten over a lot of my bullshit, so I am more at home with myself. I am no longer as crazy as I was when I was younger, because young people are often just so full of vim and vigor that they just spill all over the map. I've had therapy. I've had, you know, I've been knocked around by life, and so I've learned from my own pain and experience. I'm less judgmental, believe it or not. I'm less judgmental now than when I was younger. And I've been able to combine theory and practice. So before I was sexually experienced, I had a lot of theories about sex, what I believe sex was. I've been having sex since 1977. And so, Some of the things I knew about myself before I had sex with anybody else are still absolutely true. I'm still queer, I'm still bisexual, I'm still non-monogamous, I'm still all of those things. But other aspects of things I thought I knew have changed over time with experience and other people and learning how to be open to their feelings, etc. Sex, there's the emotional skill set, and by intrapersonal relationship. How integrated am I? How aware am I of my motivations, my choices, my desires, my hang-ups, my whatever. It says my interpersonal. Hello, my name's Nina. What's your name? So how do I listen well? Can I have a conversation with a person? Can I see them as a human and not a stereotype? There is my mental awareness of sex. What do I think sex is? What is my sexual education? There is my emotional awareness of sex. what does it mean to me, my fears about it, my beliefs about it, and then it's a physical skill set. Where are the parts? What are they called? How do they work? Where do they go? So the physical skill set can be taught fairly easily. Knowing the notes on the piano and then making music that moves a person. So I learned how to play the notes on the piano, but it took me years to learn how to really integrate it into my behavior and my emotional interaction with the other person to make a harmonious experience for everybody, including myself.
You know, concluding question. I mean, you've been such a master of reinventing yourself and staying relevant. You're, as I said, nursing background. Now you're a historian, sex educator, still doing your film work. What advice do you have about that, about why some folks can reinvent themselves, or how should folks think about their life in the public eye? I mean, how have you done it?
Well, I've done it because I have my firm belief and my fundamental message has never wavered. And my own journey back into my body is still ongoing, of course, but I'm my own best advertisement because it works for me. If it can work for me, it can work for anybody.
So gracious with your time. But very quickly, where can folks find you online, your email, your contact info, if they want to reach out to you?
The best way to get a hold of me, honestly, is Twitter, and my Twitter handle is @NinaLands. My Not Safe for Work website is Nina.com, Not Safe for Work. Don't go there from work or you'll be sorry or fired. And then my book is Nina Hartley's Guide to Total Sex. And then I have a 39-volume video sex education series from Adam and Eve called basically the Nina Hartley Guide to the Guide. If you go to Adam and Eve, look for Nina Hartley Guides. Some of the topics will be, there are 38 topics. One of them will work for you. And there you have it.
All right, Nina, I want to thank you so much. Greatly appreciated. So kind of sharing. We will certainly have to sit down again at the Chauncey DeVega Show and do this again. Much appreciated.
Wonderful conversation. I really like the part where Nina, Ms. Hartley, however she wants to have that honorific, that title, where Nina talks about being better or being a better lover as you age because you get to know your body more and your own pleasure and your sense of confidence grows. And I think in terms of sort of thinking about positive sexual health, being a sexually healthy person, being a sex positive person, that's so important. It's nothing sadder than you read these stories or see documentaries or hear women and men talking about they didn't really get the freaky deaky groove on until their 50s or 60s or 70s. Women saying they've never had an orgasm because they didn't want to lie to their husbands and partners until they were in their 40s or 50s and bought a vibrator or were actually with a partner who would listen and slow down and say, baby, what do you need? Because I get off on you getting off. So that was just some great advice from Nina. I mentioned it before, I think, a conversation with Roz DeShivo. That great book, I remember, Barnes & Noble. Go back to that podcast. Looking at them sex books and buying them. The folks didn't know what to do with a high school, middle school age guy who wasn't getting the ladies as much as he would like and taking them on Space Mountain. Not because it wasn't offered, but because he had no game. And they're ready to go on Space Mountain and you're talking yourself out of it. There was a book called She Comes First. That was one of the best purchases I ever made. That's all I'll say. So Nina Hartley, cool, 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 fun guest. Intelligent, charming, and it's so full of energy. As you drove that Cadillac car around them corners with some real speed, had me holding on to the seatbelt, but I didn't fall out the car. So that's all that I asked. So she and I are going to have to chop it up again. And again, I want to thank her one more time. So do seek out her work online. Her videos are great. Her lectures, she just has a great conversation with the Young Turks, which is as fascinating. And I'm overusing that word fascinating. I'm going to come up with a new one, which is interesting and curious in a surprising way. I.e. fascinating, with the Young Turks, really, really good. And the body language of the host is really fascinating. If you look at his eyes and he's processing and trying to come up with these questions and keep his cool, is really, really good. But I really like Saint Gangari, cool guy. That's another one of the folks on my bucket list. I'd love to sit down and chop it up, just like I do on a regular basis with the good people at Ring of Fire Radio and TV. So as I always say, please email them too and say, hey, man, we need some more Chauncey DeVega here on Ring of Fire. Because we're trying to figure that out. But a little push and help for the friends and fans of the Chauncey DeVega Show, the website Indomitable, would be much welcome. See, I'm giving out all these requests. That's two requests now, iTunes and that. Oh, well, being real. Oh, well, keeping it real. You know, I occasionally give movie recommendations. I mentioned it on Twitter for folks who follow me on Twitter. Saw that great movie, Sicario. See that movie. I mean, it's sharp. It's smart. It's about the drug war. And it does something that I just really respect as a student of film in terms of sort of the narrative and visual frame. Where, again, going to the movies is a bargain, and Sicario takes that bargain and makes the audience complicit with the violence on screen. And I'm sitting there looking at these folks, as I think I alluded to this last week, too, I hinted at it, these folks looking at the screen, and it's like they got punched in the stomach. They got punched in the stomach. They thought it was going to be a mindless action movie, and they leave there devastated and soiled because the blood is on their hands too. There's a few movies I was thinking, what would be a good companion to that? I'm going to see it again. I'm going to see Sicario again. I'm going to probably go see that chess movie. And I want to see The Martian, but my man, his white splaining about Hollywood turned me off. So he may lose some money from Chauncey DeVega. Chauncey DeVega, they put that on his sneak in special. I'm not going to give him my money, though. See, when you run your mouth and you say stuff without thinking about race and Hollywood and power, you lose money. And I think everybody else who's offended by Mr. Damon's comments should also boycott the movie and email him and tell him why. Think before you open your mouth and engage in some white racial frame nonsense about the production of film in Hollywood. Because, of course, white, male, eyes not opened, or at least as open as they should be on these issues, he doesn't want to critically indict his own success, because to engage in a conversation about white privilege, the business of Hollywood, the fact that it was upwards of 95% of the shot callers in Hollywood are white and male, very limited social network, and not out of malice, but just out of bad habit and laziness, they've created a bubble around themselves, so their success is earned. And anyone else who calls out the inherent inequalities in the system that results in art being made that is not as sophisticated and smart and rich, because I don't care about the diversity thing, that has no interest to me. My claim on these things is you could be making more money. Putting black and brown people in stuff just for the sake of doing it is of no interest. It's like you shouldn't cast white people just because they're comfortable and familiar to put the best people and you reach out and make better art. But that having been said, doing the end around, yeah, so Sicario would be one movie that is recent memory. I mean, this is punch in the stomach. Go check it out, but be ready. And maybe bring a swig of liquor with you when you go see it. And it's also cool to have an Easter egg. You don't often get to see Delta Force and all the interesting stuff going on with the CIA and the drug war. And that's based on real historical events, folk. So do a little research. Sicario is more truth than it is fiction, especially with some of the stuff that went down in Colombia. And also Nicaragua, too. But I'll leave it at that. You folks can do the research. So another movie that would sort of be good with the themes of the border, the hinterland, that no man, no woman's land between America, the U.S., and Latin and South America. I was going to say No Country for Old Men. Same cinematographer, by the way. Beautifully shot movie. That would have to be in the lineup if we're doing like an evening viewing. We're curating a night of movies with similar themes about drugs and the border and migration. So Sicario, No Country for Old Men. The Counselor, which some people hated, I loved. It's a movie that has nothing but contempt for the audience. Punches you right in the face. A movie from, I believe it came out in the 70s or 80s. It still moves me to this day. And I saw it in high school, watched it again in college several times. And this is a hard view. It's a movie called El Norte. Definitely check out El Norte. And a sci-fi genre movie. And the sequel to it disappointed, as did Godzilla, made by the same director. What happens when you give somebody, a writer-director, money and toys they are not used to working with? They make a crappy movie like Godzilla. And that movie is Monsters, I believe it's called Monsters, about the border and aliens, crash land, and the hinterland between the U.S. and Mexican border. I mean, it's an obvious metaphor for migration of the drug trade. It's overrun with these monsters from outer space who just want to be left alone. Some of them are harmful, some of them are dangerous, and it's basically man versus intergalactic monsters that are terraforming, not with intent, at least from what we see in the first one, but this is just their habitat. So they become the new dinosaurs. Some of them look like huge walking fishes and mushrooms. So check that out. So there'll be a nice evening of curated viewing of films about the border. But again, I don't often endorse films here. You know, I'm very picky. See Sicario. It's a hell of a movie. Hell of a movie. So one last swig of the Coca-Cola. This is a 4 or 5 swig episode. And I'm indulging myself because it was so much fun to sit down and talk with Nina. And the fall is here and that red blood moon and great conversations this week and other fun stuff forthcoming. Cutting promos on Uncle Ben Carson. Got another piece coming out, Jeb Bush and white people wanting free stuff. I think business is about to pick up. And as I've been hinting, good stuff is coming. We just got to keep the pedal to the metal. And we'll know very shortly, January, February, where we're going to end up with this thing. So, as I said, y'all along for the ride. So either our semi-truck is going to roll over and we're going to have to ride and keep on going, or we're going to make this turn. And some wonderful things, even more wonderful things are going to happen because of all you guys and your kind support of the website and the podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. So next episode, as I said, I've been previewing and hinting, so I'm going to start doing this more often. Next episode, the episode after that, etc. But I'm going to leave you with this tease. I'm not going to tell you what's coming after this upcoming episode. It'll be a surprise. So hopefully I'll find out on Thursday or Friday who it's going to be. But next week's episode, long in process, you know, I do these ahead of time, and he and I sat down and had to sit down again because of technical difficulties. And it's a conversation for grown folk. So cover up the kids' ears. It's not nasty. It's just two grown ass folk talking real about race, sex, politics, the body, and art. So friend of the website, cool guy. Cool brother. We'll have to have him on. As I said, he just got back from Europe. He was in Germany, I believe. And then I think he was in Sweden or Switzerland. He gets around. M. Lamar, performance artist, opera singer, world class. New York Times last year reviewed his work, Negro Gothic. And I hate to introduce folk by referencing their relatives, but as I said, you know, he also had a guest spot, two episodes, I believe, on Orange is the New Black, because he is the brother of Laverne Cox. And M. Lamar, go online, type his name in, you'll see some really cool stuff on YouTube. Panel discussion with Bell Hooks, Samuel Delaney, I believe. And he's just smart, fun, interesting. He and I were laughing, talking about sex, talking about performance art, talking about pegging. You know what pegging is, one of his installations, where he's exploring race, sex, BDSM, dominance, and submission, as you know, across the color line. And I tried not to laugh, but it was so real, telling a story about one of his exhibits where he had to have white men nude, and they were examining questions, I guess the conservatives would not like, or maybe they would be titillated by this story about what it's like to have all those naked bodies on the screen being penetrated anally and their states of arousal. But it's much more than that. We also talk about public art, the movie Django, funding, finding your life path, Europe and America, and art and race. And as I said, he's so patient, MMR. You can hear that in my voice. Like, I've had this conversation done for almost a year. And I kept saying, next week, next week, next week, next week, because it's so good. It's so smart. And I was like, I got to have the right episode before, the right episode after. And I said, what the heck? Nina Hartley's number one, M. Lamar be number two. So I'm excited by it. I think you're really, really, really going to enjoy it and like it. And that's coming up next week on the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. So as is our standard closer, you know me, as is our standard closer. And I had to take a pause there because I have mentioned this before. I live next to two sex freaks who are human wildebeests. Now, I'm whispering. They seem like nice people. And I don't know what that man is doing to her. And I should put the microphone up to the wall so you can hear this and know that I'm not BSing you. But I've heard him do the alphabet on the coochie. I've heard her moans of ecstasy and thanking her man for being so generous to her and loving her so good. And at first it was titillating. But now it's just annoying. And see, that's the ambiance you get on the podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. As I'm doing my intros and outros, you never know. Sometimes it's the bus. Sometimes it's a train. Sometimes it's the arsonist across the street. And sometimes it's a woman with her man's head buried between her legs, doing the freaky deaky. But because I respect people's privacy, and they are nice people, I will not subject you to her moans of ecstasy. Sometimes you gotta laugh. So, as is my standard outro, please be good, kind, and nice to your animal friends. The dogs, the cats, the birds, the lizards, my pet-friendly spider. I'm trying not to laugh as I do this outro. Alrighty. Try not to laugh, as I say. Please be good, be kind, be nice to our animal friends, winged, reptilian, fish, and other dogs and cats. Our bird friends, our squirrel friends, all creatures, big and small. And as I always say, please try to be nice to each other. Show some love to our homeless brothers and sisters. Be kind, and call up a friend or relative you've had a falling out with, because trust me, get it off your chest. At least you know you tried to be the bigger person. You tried to do the right thing. You tried to extend your hand in friendship. Send a letter. Or send an email, but emails are easier to ignore. Or if you're really bold and brave, pick up the telephone. And I didn't do it before, but you think I'm gonna forget? I want to thank all the folks who routinely donate on a monthly basis to support the opportunity cost, time, and energy that it takes to put together the Chauncey DeVega Show, and also the website, chaunceydevega.com, a.k.a. Indomitable, a.k.a. W-A-R-N, a.k.a. in the near recent past, We Are Respectable Negroes, W-A-R-N. That's where that comes from. Appreciate those monthly donors. But if you can, if you have not done so as of yet, if you have the resources, if you have discovered a pile of money
If you were cleaning out the cushions in your car, you value what we do and the fun randomness and the intelligent conversation and the fun things that happen, like people getting a freaky deaky on fire trucks and buses, conversations with Nina Hartley, reflections on Ben Carson, my Coca-Cola drinking, and my singing of various musical anthems like dun dun dun, ooh, dun dun dun, dun dun dun, dun dun dun. Please go to that PayPal link on the right-hand side of the website of the sidebar, ChaunceyVega.com. Hit that. Dollar, 50 cents, a quarter, $5, $10. All goes to good use. All goes to good use. Pay for the hosting. And then goes into the coffers to support the various other things and resources. And I won't lie, to get a brother an occasional hamburger or beer after he puts in the hours necessary to do the production interviews. As I said, each episode probably takes about 4 to 5 hours. I've actually, on the MMR episode, because we had to do it twice, that took about 6 or 7 hours. I am not lying. It was fun. But at a certain point, you call up a friend and be like, hey, we got to redo this conversation because I cannot clean this audio up. Until next week, please be safe, be well, and do take care of yourself. And thank you for listening.